And Church, we're located at 530 Northwest 4th Street in Faribault, Minnesota. This morning's service is the Divine Service 4, and we'll be singing the following hymns, number 516, Wake, Awake, for the Night is Flying, number 680, Thine the Amen, Thine the Praise, number 663, Rise My Soul to Watch and Play, number 672, Jerusalem, the Golden, and number 527, O Savior, Precious Savior. Our speaker this morning will be our Reverend Dr. Michael Nerva, who will be speaking upon The Kingdom of God Comes. Our presiding pastor this morning will be our Pastor Paul Rieger, and the Trinity Handbell Choir will be playing, as well as the Trinity Choir will be singing during this morning's service. We ask you to join us as we open our service with hymn number 516 in the Lutheran Service Book, Wake, Awake, for Night is Flying.
Thank you. Please stand. We begin this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of our God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Let us join together in prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, so govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that ever mindful of your glorious return, we may preserve in both faith and holiness of living. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading this morning comes to us from the book of Daniel, the 7th chapter. As I looked, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and came out from before him. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were opened. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven there came one like a son of man, And he came to the Ancient of Days, and he was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading comes to us from Revelation, the first chapter. Grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. This too is the word of the Lord. Thank you, Handbell Choir. That was very well done. Please rise for the reading of our Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 18th chapter. So Pilate entered his headquarters and again called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not of this world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated, and I would like to invite the children forward for the children's message.
Well, good morning to all of you. Oops. We have a microphone? I'll just do what I do at home. I'll yell louder. That's okay. Oh, look at all the people we have. My goodness. Children, more children, more children. More people. Well, I'm going to ask you two questions. First of all, what's it mean to be in charge? Yes. Oh, you're responsible? Okay. What else?
It means that you take care of it.
All right. Good. You can boss people around. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You forgot? That happens. Maybe you can think of it. Yes? No? Okay. How about anyone else? Who's in charge at your house? Oh, okay, everyone is. Please. Mom is? Okay, good. Yeah?
My dad.
Your dad is? Good. Okay, someone is, yes.
Jesus.
Jesus is in charge of your house. Wow, that's wonderful. Yes?
Mom, Dad, and
Jesus. Mom, Dad, and Jesus. Well, that's the ultimate answer. There we go. Now, that's good because that means it's very important. Well, that's good because, you know, when we look at the church, who do you think's in charge here? Yes?
Jesus.
Well, what do you think that looks like if Jesus is in charge? That's a tough one. Okay. Let's have our second question. Look at this. What's that? Yes?
The Bible.
Well, it's a hymnal, but that thing there, that little squiggly thing, yes?
It's a cross.
It's a cross. Look at how many crosses we have. Well, how many crosses do you think there are in church? I mean, here's one. If you think about every book.
There's
one behind me. Oh, there's a big one. You look at those windows over there. Two crosses.
And over, right behind you again.
And behind me again. Oh. Well, if you look at it, is there any other more crosses?
Right there.
Oh, around my neck.
Right there.
And here. Oh. I bet we could find crosses everywhere in the church. Now that's how Jesus leads. What does the cross mean? Yes?
It means Jesus took away our sins.
That's right. Jesus died on the cross to save our sins. We celebrate that he leads because he saves us. He tells us this in his word and helps us all the time that he leads in our lives, no matter where we are. At play, at home, everywhere. And after we celebrate this, because this is Christ the King Day. Now, maybe during the service, you'll be looking around and thinking, how many crosses are there? Maybe some of the adults will when their mind wanders during the sermon. Now, that being said, let's have a little word of prayer. You can fold your hands, bow your heads, even close your eyes. Lord Jesus.
We thank you
for being our King
and saving us.
Help us
to serve one another.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the acolyte is going to bring you candy. There it is, right there. Please don't trample him or me.
Thank you, TJ.
Please join me in prayer. O Lord God, Heavenly Father, be with us this day in our meditations and grant to us your Holy Spirit. As we consider your Son, Jesus Christ, who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and of his kingdom and of the fact that he is the truth. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So it is, dear friends in Christ, we celebrate Christ the King Sunday. And in our meditation today, which comes from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 18, 28 through 38, we consider all that Jesus is and all that he will be, that he is a king and that he is truth. As we find our lesson, Jesus is before Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor. And on this occasion, the Lord God has seen fit to have the powerful official of Rome meet Jesus, who is Savior and Lord. The governor looks at Jesus, who has already had a very hard time of it. Jesus sleepless. Jesus who had been beaten. Jesus now turned over by the authorities of his own people. And Jesus then stands. The governor looks him over. I'm sure he thought, this man is no threat. What has he done? And, of course, the Jewish officials are couching the charge in a way that Rome would understand. They say, he has claimed to be a king. We have no king but Caesar. They have to do so because if they don't do this, what exactly is Pontius Pilate going to make of this? Some sort of fight over your religion, a squabble about rules? But the charge is that of sedition, treason. This man makes himself king. And so Jesus comes and faces him, and the governor asks plainly, are you a king? Maybe Pilate says that with a smirk. Are you a king? And Jesus says very plainly, for this reason I've come into the world to tell the truth. My kingdom is not of this world. Well, there it is. The kingdom of which Jesus has is not of this world. Pilate, of course, hears the answer. So close is Pilate to the kingdom of God, and yet so far away. And yet what is the kingdom? Jesus is so right. Jesus himself and his kingdom is not of this world. The kingdoms of this world, as even Pilate knows, are ones that are in power. They make buildings, they make roads, they collect taxes, they protect their citizens. Well, to some degree, we have a little bit of Pilate in us as well. We like effective and efficient government. We like the government to do something about our situation to keep us protected. We like to make sure that they do road maintenance. We like to make sure that all sorts of things are happening. We want running water in our houses. And we like this kind of idea too. Pilate, of course, looks at Jesus and of this kingdom, which obviously is of no threat, and thinks, that's not a problem. Later on, of course, when Pilate washes his hands of the entire situation and said, I find no basis of any charge, you see to it yourself. He realizes this kingdom, which is not of this world, is nothing. Or so he thinks. I mean, if it were nothing, when Jesus is crucified outside the city gates of Jerusalem, he would have been a nobody. No one would remember it. No one could consider it. And yet that kingdom, which is not of this world, is greater than any kingdom which is here on earth. It is one by which the Son of God dies for the sins of the world. That this kingdom, which does not look very powerful indeed, is more powerful than anything else. And long after Rome was nothing more than ruins, this kingdom continues and will do so forever. That this blood of Jesus, who is above his head on that cross with the title, and his charge was, this is the King of the Jews. Well, he is King of all. By his blood, he cleansed the entire sins of the world and offered a one-time sacrifice for the sins of all, that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. It's a simple offer, and yet there are so many who will not receive it. It's a simple offer. Believe, and you can have the certainty of salvation. Believe, and all your sins will be forgiven. As it says, the prophet Isaiah is very clear about it. They're dropped into the very depth of the sea. In those days when you could not get down past where you could dive, the depth of the sea was unreachable. In other words, when your sins are forgiven, they're down to the bottom, and please don't go fishing because you will not be able to get them back. Your sins are forgiven as far as the east is from the west, and the two don't meet. Even though your sins are as scarlet, like red, they'll be made white as wool. That's how perfect this atonement is. And yet Pilate is so close to the kingdom of God and so far. He is like so many people, as I say today, who just don't understand. After all, don't the violent take it by force? Aren't there those religions today who keep trying to declare jihad and destroy? To say we must claim it for our God? Isn't this world full of violence? And trouble, and pain, and agony? Where is this kingdom sometimes in our lives, even we who are believers? Why doesn't God do something about it all? Why not get rid of all these nasty fellows and their bombs and their terroristic threats? Why not do something about the terrible situations of this world? After all, think about how brief life could be, even for us. Sitting, if we were in some French cafe or maybe downtown or somewhere else, and death comes raining down on us, a bomb, an explosion, some madman with a gun, someone saying they're doing this in the name of their prophet because that's how it has to be. And where is God doing then? Where is the kingdom which is not of this world? Where is that divine protection and the help? We're reminded that many of those apostles, the apostles themselves, endured martyr's death. Paul himself is beheaded. Peter, we're told in church history, is crucified upside down. They all die grisly deaths. Where is this kingdom of God? Well, it's not an earthly kingdom, dear friends. And I don't want to overlook the idea today of angelic protection. For truly, the Lord God does grant such angelic protection to us. He protects us. And it tells us in Psalm 91 that the angels will make sure that we will not dash our foot against a stone, and yet there will be times of testing, testing of our faith, testing of who we are, testing to the very moorings of our being, of what we are about. And Jesus, who is the very King of kings and Lord of lords, if he suffers, then his servants will suffer as well. We do not bear a crown of glory, but we many times will bear the cross and carry it, as Jesus says. Pick up your cross and follow me. It's not a pillow, it's not a comforter, it's not a light backpack. The cross is a means of death. And yet, the cross is everywhere. In Roman times, in Jesus' time, it was an instrument of torture and pain. No Roman citizen could be crucified. Why, even the early church did not have crosses in the church. Isn't that wild? I mean, it's like if I were to bring to you an electric chair and put it right in the middle of the church. Or maybe a table for lethal injection. It will remind you of death. And so it is that the early church always liked the fish because it had that great acronym, Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior. And yet now crosses are everywhere. Jesus, of course, says that as we will suffer in this world for his name, we are still to declare his name. Pilate never understands that. He looks at Jesus. He realizes his kingdom is of no benefit. Doesn't look like it. And he really asked Jesus this question as you look at our lesson. Jesus, of course, says that he is the truth. And to this reason, as we find in the Gospel of John 8:32, the truth will set you free. Pilate looks at him and says, "What is truth?" Turns on his heel, he walks away. Yet Jesus is truth. His kingdom is truth. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." John 14:6. Jesus is the only way of heaven. In Acts 4:12, salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Salvation, then, is so important. And there is truth. Well, we find the relativism of this world is so very crazy. You find that people say there is no truth. There is nothing to be gained. The only thing you can probably do is probably figure out maybe some sort of answer that might fit this situation or that. And so the kingdoms of this world continue to wax and wane, to try and solve their problems and try to do things in a very humanistic manner. But this kingdom of which we speak of here in church, this kingdom of which Jesus establishes, the one that grants crosses to people to bear, the one that grants strength for people to be able to bear their crosses and to testify of his name, is also a kingdom which is far greater than any earthly kingdom. It has no boundaries. It has no time period. It encompasses all those who are believers of different nationalities, of different social and ethnic groups, of different places throughout the world. And if you will, dear friends, from the very beginning of the world, Adam and Eve looked forward to such a promise when it was told in Genesis 3:15. That the one who is born of woman will crush the head of the serpent, but he would strike his heel. It goes through all the Old Testament, which looks forward to the coming of the Messiah, and to all of us who looked to the cross and he who died for us. This is a kingdom greater than all. As we celebrate Christ the King Sunday, we're reminded of this, that this is an impressive kingdom. For Pilate, so close, and yet so far. And yet how many times do we remember Pilate? Oh, not in a good way, mind you. It's a historical fact of our confession in the creed, crucified under Pontius Pilate. And Pilate, governor, well, his political fortunes change, as we're told. In one story in church history, we're told that things reversed on him in a very bad way. And he had a very nice house. It overlooked a wonderful lake high above on a like of a rocky mountain. And one day, Pilate, for all the acclaim he had had, for all the money he possessed, for all the good things that he had, decided to throw himself off, and he missed the lake and bounced down the cliff. It's a shame. We're told that the servants didn't even notice for a very long time. And so he died. So close to the kingdom of God and so far. The kingdom of God, dear friends, is not of this world, as we're not of this world. Greater than any earthly kingdom, greater than any prize, prestige, the eternal crown of glory which is given to all who believe in him. And then as we celebrate Christ the King Sunday, we're reminded that there is a place for us in heaven, a place which is the greatest treasure of all, a place where our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, in a place of love and of fulfillment forever. In Jesus' name, dear friends, may we be kept in that one true faith and be ready for the day of which he comes again as Savior and as our Lord. In Jesus' name, dear friends, amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in that one true faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. unto life everlasting. Amen. Please rise. We confess then our Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed as printed in your bulletin. We confess then together, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We remain standing for the prayers.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who has come into our world, who has brought his kingdom to us that we should live. We pray thanks for the one who is, who was, who is, and who is to come, that he is on our side, that his favor is pointed in our direction. And we praise and thank you for all the work that he has done for us. But we also pray, Lord, that his kingdom would come, that your kingdom would come, that we would enter into glory with you and spend eternity in paradise. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for all of those in need of strength, comfort, and healing. We especially lift up Emily Delasky, Elda Fuchs, John Maluski, Donna Ray Schultz, Mary Ellen Velsky, and Jane Lures, and for all of those names who we carry in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for the atrocities of this world, for those victims who have suffered many horrible realities of sin. We pray for the victims of the recent attack in Paris. We pray for the victims of the terrorist attack in the hotel in Mali last Friday. And we pray, Lord, that you would send your protection to all those who are persecuted, that you would be with military and support personnel to protect and keep alive those who are being attacked. But we also pray that here locally you would be with police and other support personnel to take care of us at home. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the family and friends of Jenny, the aunt of Roberta, who passed away this past 14th. We also pray for the friends, family and friends of Kenneth Reinecke, brother of Bob, who passed away on the 15th in Lebanon, Oregon. We pray, Lord, that you would comfort both of these families and all families who are suffering loss. Comfort them with the reassurance that your kingdom is coming, that your resurrection is coming, and that day will be a glorious day when we will all be raised to your glory and joined in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, for faithful servants of the gospel, for faithful pastors to serve your churches all over the world, but we also pray, Lord, for missionaries who are spreading your message of truth, the message of your kingdom to people who have not heard it. We especially lift up Tim and Beth, their son Jonathan, who has major heart problems. We pray for Beth as she travels to the U.S. For Thanksgiving and an early Christmas with her family. We pray for Tim as he stays behind. We pray for their niece Mallory, who will be working with them following Christmas. And we give you thanks, Lord, that their work at the clinic and the witnessing that is taking place there, that they are proclaiming your love and your truth. And we give thanks for the opportunities that they have had to pray for people in town. We pray, Lord, that their prayers would lead to questions about Jesus, in whose name we pray. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated, and we will now take this time to worship the Lord by gathering our tithes and offerings. I would encourage you also to fill out the red friendship pads at the end of your pews. Thank you, choir. Please rise for the service of the sacraments. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death, that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. We pray. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Join us now as we have our communion distribution hymns, number 663 in the Lutheran Service Book, "Rise My Soul to Watch and Pray," and number 672 in the Lutheran Service Book, "Jerusalem the Golden." As we come to the close of another service here at Trinity, we hope it has been a blessing to you. This morning's broadcast was from Trinity Lutheran Church. We're located at 530 Northwest 4th Street in Faribault, Minnesota. This morning, our speaker was our pastor, Michael Nerva, who spoke on The Kingdom of God Comes. Our presiding pastor was our pastor, Paul Rieger. Organist this morning was Barb Morasco and the Trinity Handbell Choir, and the Trinity Choirs performed at our service this morning. We'd like to thank the following. In memory of SF Smoky Cross, a gift has been given by the family, by Dennis and Pat Blackmer, by Vernon Cross, and by Delna Spitzak. And in memory of Walter Putz Burkhartsmeyer, we'd like to thank the following for their gifts: Julie Anderson, Marion Ball, Paul Bardall, Margaret Barda, Dennis and Pat Blackmer, Steve and Maureen Brand, Al and Irma Burkhartsmeyer, Barry and Janice Burkhartsmeyer, Peter Burkhartsmeyer Jr., Henry and Lisa Bush, Father Henry Doyle, Chuck and Judy Faircloth, C. Elizabeth Gudnick, Lowell Hetlevet, Randy and Kathy Johnson, Dale and Teresa Kelm, Ramona and Frederick Keene, Roger and Kat Kuchman, Ruby and Stephen Mearspachtel, Jewel Moldenhauer, Gary and Barb Morasco, Wayne and Marilyn Nelson, Glenn and Shirley Norgard, Mertis Reck, Linda Rohde, Janet Rich, Elmer Schultz, Pastor Bob and Margaret Snyder, Carol Springmeyer, Eugene and Pat Trench, Robert and Kay Marie Trench, Larry and Barb Tweet, Dan and Judy Valentine, Helen Velsky, Brian Wagstrom, Roger and Marge Wolkowski, Paul and Kay Wazinka, Mr. and Mrs. Earl Young, and by various other members of the family. It's your cards, gifts, and letters that keep our broadcast here on KDHL. We've been on since 1948. You can hear our services each Sunday morning here at 8 a.m., or you can visit us here at the church at 5:30 p.m. on Saturday evenings and 8 o'clock and 10:30 a.m. here on Sunday mornings. You can visit us on the internet at www.trinityradioandvideo.org, where you can see what's going on at the church and see our services. We invite you to join us next week, Sunday morning at 8 a.m., and until then, we return you down to the downtown studios of KDHL.